Everybody's stepping up their I get that WWEF voice going, like when I start.
Let's go now.
That's
ladies and gentlemen.
It's the new on location Stone Fruit Coffee in Poland, Ohio. Do your live marketing show. Trying to be subdued, but I'm properly caffeinated at this point. And it's great to be back with the first guest into the new year. An amazing opportunity to sit down with my good friends at iSynergy. We've got some big, exciting news to drop on our fans today and on our DOYO Live community. What else do we have going on? What are we going to talk about? We're going to talk about a little bit about coffee. No, we're going to talk about brand, and we're going to talk about how, if you have an established brand, what do you do when you try to dial up a new company within that brand? And we'll let you guys explain that here in just a few moments.
Without hopefully falling on your face.
So we are live on location from Stone Fruit Coffee in Poland, Ohio. I'm Dennis Chirani. For those of you who do not know, and I, for some crazy reason, got a bright idea to start a marketing conference in Youngstown, Ohio called DOYO Live. We are heading into DOYO Live in person, physically, number 5. Slight interruption with, maybe you heard there was a global pandemic, but we're coming back next August, September in 2022 for a big, big outing. Speakers, sponsors, the whole nine. So we're really looking forward to getting together with everybody and our attendees. In the meanwhile, we are going to be back here live every Friday as much as we possibly can with different guests coming in, hanging out, supporting local business. And we're going to talk marketing. We're going to talk current events. We're going to talk all kinds of fun stuff. I've got some really great guests coming up next week. Diana Kaufman is from Poland, Ohio. Originally, she's an entrepreneur living in Pittsburgh. So she's coming back. And then after the week after that, I don't know if you guys know Mr. Jiu-Jitsu. Do you know Mr. Jiu-Jitsu? If you don't know Mr. Jiu-Jitsu, you need to go to Facebook today and look him up. I'm not going to let it too much out of the bag, but he's amazing on Facebook. That's all I'm going to say.
Mr. Jiu-Jitsu.
And I'm going to stop there. So anyway, this is your show, not Mr. Jiu-Jitsu's. Jiu-Jitsu.
Say that fast 3 times.
Holy crap. My friends from iSynergy are here today. Steve Cross, creative director, founder, owner, likes to be referred to as creative director. Becky Bertuzzi. What is your role at iSynergy?
It varies from day to day, but the official title is growth marketing specialist.
Growth marketing. And we got Dan Reese.
I am an iSynergy SEO specialist.
Gotcha. Good stuff. So one of the things that we want to talk about today a little bit, I want to get into kind of that brand conversation. And you've got a new brand. Yep. You're iSynergy. So you've just like kind of high level. iSynergy has been around for
10 years now. We've been growing. You know, one of the reasons for it, you know, Lyft Marketing, it's a local division is how we're framing it of iSynergy. And the reason for that is, you know, marketing 101, what's your goal? Who's your audience? As we've grown, you know, we grew from just me by myself, and my audience and my customer persona and who I was targeting was anybody Cleveland, Pittsburgh regionally that had a digital marketing need, SEO, paid, programmatic, website development, design, you name it, social media, inbound. But as you grow, you know, hopefully, you know, your growth, your audience evolves with you. And that's drastically changed the last couple of years, especially with the pandemic that you talked about. Everybody's traditional budgets, and you know, conferences are getting canceled left and right. Those traditional budgets are going digital, and they're like, I have this extra 50 grand we used to sponsor this show for. I used to send 5 to 10 people to this conference. What do we do with this budget now?
Sure.
Everything went digital.
Yeah.
As long as they were a progressive company and wanted to keep growing and sustain their growth and not shrink and, you know, just.
And reach people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what that did is that put us, you know, we were gradually getting there. iSynergy was over the last couple of years. But what that did is it basically hockey sticked us on the national, international scale. We have, you know, we have about 200 clients between Cleveland and Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
But we also have clients in Florida, Kansas, Missouri, New York, up and down the East Coast, Switzerland, London, South Africa, Saudi Arabia, you name it.
Wow.
We're global, you know, so
it's amazing.
Yeah, it's kind of, It is. It's hard to believe a lot of times, but you know, we just stayed the course and we've just grown. Now, as we've done that, it's how do we talk to, and this is something probably everybody in the audience has an issue with, and you probably talk to clients and people that you consult with. Who's your audience? Talk to your audience specifically. Don't just say your message out there. You have personas, you have your different audience segments, your cohorts, talk to them directly. And iSynergy's huge issue problem was I'm talking to national and international clients that have seven-figure budgets.
Sure.
I'm also talking to the client in Poland, Ohio, Canfield, Columbiana, you know, Warren, where their budget is, you know, $500 for the year.
Right.
We help them all. We don't discriminate against the budgets or their needs or how comprehensive or dynamic their needs are, their strategies are. And that's difficult to do. You know, it's like everybody you talk to, we've been through it 100 times. You talk to a client and they're like, well, who's your audience? Well, I can sell something to anybody. Well, no shit, you can. But who's your target audience and where do you make your money? Because they're probably, your revenue's probably coming to a 90%. If you figure out that cohort, if that audience segment's probably 90% of your revenue.
Yeah.
You know, and define that. Don't just say, well, I'll just spread my word everywhere and hopefully they find me.
Right.
You know, and so we were falling into that trap ourselves. So what we did is we decided, you know, there's two ways to go with that. And this is maybe it's too much information, but it's trim the fat, make a line. If your budget isn't X, we can't work with you.
Yeah.
Or if you don't have this type of need, we can't work with you.
Sure.
And I didn't want to do that because I built my business. I have clients from 10 years ago when I started, when I was by myself.
Yeah.
That have seen us grow. And I didn't want to take that approach.
Sure.
I want to keep those clients. I love those clients. The startups are actually where we get energized from, you know, because they don't have the budgets per se most of the time,
right?
But they have the energy, they have the motivation, and it's energizing when they walk in to the office. So what we decided to do is create our local division, Lift Marketing, that services the local geo between Cleveland and Pittsburgh. There are some budgetary, or if they have some strategic needs, comprehensive, you know, needs when it comes to the marketing, their campaigns and strategies that they want to execute, that they may end up as an iSynergy client. But for the most part here locally in this market, everyone's going to be a Lyft Marketing client.
Sure.
Now, it's not something that we want to hide. Like it says right in the tagline, a division of iSynergy, you know, so we're not trying to, you know, pull the wool over anybody's eyes or do anything like that.
Yeah.
Actually use the same colors, you know?
Yeah.
Right. Right.
And you'll notice like in the Lyft logo, there's, I almost called you Josie, that Becky designed. There's some consistency between the iSynergy logo and there's some relationship there that you'll see. So it wasn't anything we wanted to hide. Basically we wanted to say thank you to this base because that's where iSynergy grew from.
Right.
And we didn't want to leave our roots. We didn't want to abandon that. We wanted to stay true to that and always help here locally. You know, so iSynergy is going to take like the leadership roles in iSynergy staff wise, resource wise. We're going to be spending more time on those clients and dive deeper with them. And they're going to have less clients to work with, but Lyft Marketing, you know, we're going to keep those clients and we're just keep churning out for the local people here.
I think that's great. And I've got like a ton of follow-up questions on that.
It's the most I've ever talked to the entire time. I've been on this podcast.
Yeah. I'm actually pretty shocked. I thought it was going to be 5 words and we're done.
We could just go home.
Yeah. We're done. I'll see you guys later.
Actually, we could rebrand this as the Steve Show.
Yeah.
And we're done.
Yeah. Dennis was getting antsy because he was trying to.
I got like really cool ideas for a logo.
I got to stop with the brain because I'm just trying to listen, but I'd like it. And so I feel like DOYO Live is now Prince because we're DOYO Live presented formerly known as like by iSynergy.
But now it's Lyft.
Now he's causing me a ton of work. He's a great sponsor. And I mean that wholeheartedly because, you know, over the past 2 years, like we talked about, like we didn't deliver a physical event. We've always had the online content. We built the audience. But there's something to the in-person event, and you guys stuck by us through that. So with that said, DOYO Live is now presented by Lyft Marketing.
obviously it fits. It's in the local community. And so what are the two of you going to be doing? Are you focused on Lyft?
Yeah.
All right.
I will be the art director for Lyft, and Dan is our fearless leader, and he will be the creative director for Lyft.
Not sure how I feel about that term leader, but I am the creative director. So a similar role to what Steve does for iSynergy, I'll be handling with Lyft. The first point of contact with new clients, kind of overseeing all the campaigns and just touching a little bit of everything in the company.
Sure. So what's the biggest challenge what's the challenge that comes with, you have a company, you have a brand, you're known as iSynergy, right? People recognize that. And now you're introducing another brand under the brand. And I live it kind of on a daily basis with DOYO, Dennis, and then, you know, some of the other things that I've got going on with Icons Publication and in the consulting business. But what are some of the challenges that come along with when you've got the brand and now you're going to introduce a brand that's underneath that or side by side with it, really? I hate to say underneath. It's here.
But alongside it. I don't know if it was the most difficult. It was the thing that I was most concerned about was communicating to our client base and having them understand what we were doing and how we were evolving without them feeling like we were banning them or leaving them in any way. I wanted to make sure that they understood that this is a successful step and it's because of them.
Right.
You know, it's because we were built on their backs and working with them. But to say that's the thing I was most concerned about, I don't think it was probably the hardest step, because that was probably the easiest now, because I've talked to clients that are like, hey, congratulations. It's awesome. Thanks for letting us know what's going on. You know, so the feedback's been great. You know, there's been some inconsistencies of, hey, I thought you were Lyft. I thought you were iSynergy. What's going on? I got this. So, you know, there hasn't been, but you know, that's been very minimal. So I to say that that was the thing I was worried about the most, for sure. But I don't think it was the hardest thing. I mean, Becky's been in the trenches for
from like a behind the scenes logistical standpoint, the hardest thing is like, and it's like starting, you're basically starting a new business. So it's like getting all of that stuff up off the ground.
Right.
And, you know, building the website, figuring out the logo, figuring out the brand itself of, you know, how do we want to present ourselves in the marketplace, and doing all of that research,
right,
to kind of get that fleshed out and hashed out. That's probably been the hardest part. I wouldn't even call it hard. I would call it tedious, because it was really fun. I mean, because the day that he told us what was going on, we were at a staff meeting and all of us immediately just started writing stuff down. Like, I have an idea for this. Yeah. I have an idea for that. Like, I came up with the idea for the logo in the shower, you know? So it's been fun to kind of take, best ideas in the shower.
Yeah, always.
But it's been fun to kind of take his idea and his vision and execute on it.
Yeah, because it really was was an idea. It was a strategy. I didn't present it to the team saying, all right, here's our new name. Here's our new logo. It was, here's how we're going to position and here's how we're going to restructure.
Right.
And, you know, because that's just how we do it. You know how we do it at iSynergy. It's a group effort. Like, I don't have the ego. I don't have all the answers. I rely on the team. I think it was fun, but like you said, it was tedious.
It was tedious because there were a couple of times where we would get so excited that we kind of got ahead of ourselves, and he'd have to go
tap the brakes.
Come on back in.
Steve and I
come on back in.
We went and had some beers and wings, and I don't know if you've ever had wings with Steve.
I have had wings with Steve.
Impressive experience. I don't know if you've done this, but like
we went a couple of weeks ago, and the amount of food that was on our table was obscene.
Yeah, like two guys there, and I'm like, but anyway, he let me know at that point. He's like, hey, you know, just sit tight. And as me with a sponsor, I'm ultra sensitive to like making sure that I'm delivering on expectations and needs. And this guy's just like cool as a cucumber. He's like, listen, we're going to do a rebrand. I don't really want, you know, keep pushing iSynergy, but don't, you know, it's coming, but don't worry about it. And like, when it comes, we'll put it. And then like, I think it was like 2 weeks ago. I mean, I know it was being worked on, right, but you're like,
you know, we're ready.
Here you go.
Here's another thing. We have another number of people on. I don't know if you know Susan Mocker, but obviously
Hi, thank you, Susan.
Deanna's hanging out. Thank you, Deanna. Hens, Kelsey Klim, Dr. Mike Sedalia, all of them wishing you happy new year and congratulations. What I also love about this is this. So unless I missed something, you've owned the story up till now, the narrative of dropping this brand. And I think that this is something that I have believed for a very long time, everybody could be their own media company now. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to rely, like, imagine there's a press release coming.
Correct.
Right. But.
But we gave DOYO.
You told your client base, I got an email. Hey, the only thing that changes is maybe the name on the invoice.
Yep.
You know, that was an email. You let everybody know internally. You're giving us the opportunity to break the news.
You bet.
So there's probably, you know, there's a news source or business journal. Somebody out there is watching this and they're going to be like, oh, like, you know, they pick it up here and then they come and cover it. That's how podcasting is working now. Like, there's a lot of stories because Vindicator is not around. They're watching live podcasts and then they're like, hey, let's go and cover this story, see if it's a news story. So I love the fact that you took the PR decision to tell your story first and then everybody else gets it next.
Well, that's kind of our way, right? You know, we've always kind of been, I get told, and I like it, that we're the hidden gem of the area because we don't, I mean, do you, this is that, and we did some business journal stuff, but locally, we kind of stay behind the scenes. You know, our business has been grown and been made on SEO, but here locally on, you know, referrals and networking.
Yeah.
You know, it's a very simple, easy way to go of do good work, treat people right, and give them the results that they want and they deserve, and your business is going to grow.
Let's pause for the cause for a minute and pay a couple bills. How about we do that? All right. Cooking with Crows. Crows Cabinets is a local company that is a sponsor of DOYO Live. They do residential kitchen remodeling, building new builds. Becky just did a new kitchen. She's lived through it. It wasn't a Crow's kitchen, but that's all right. Bathrooms.
Forgive you.
Custom storage. I would have got you a hell of a deal. Custom storage, man cave, she sheds, you name it. Crow's got you covered. So in this segment of Cooking with Crows, we need to know from each one of you either what your favorite meal is to cook or to eat in your own home kitchen. And I'll go first since I put you on the spot. If it's a Friday night, usually I'm cracking a bottle of wine, got a cast iron skillet. There's a nice meaty steak going in a reverse sear coming out. And then also a nice big salad and some garlic bread. That's one of my favorite meals on a Friday night. Cooking with Crows.
You get to stay home on a Friday night.
All the time.
So
the days are numbered, though, my friend.
This might be weird, but I actually don't do a lot of the cooking at home. My boyfriend does because he's way better at it than I am, and he enjoys it. So I would say probably one of the meals that I enjoy him to cook for me. I'm cleanup crew, by the way. It's probably steak. He does it on a charcoal grill and he'll put like apple wood or something to smoke it a little bit. That, some potatoes, a salad.
Love it.
Beer. Good to go.
Yep.
Dan?
I hate to be redundant, but a big fat rib steak on the grill, that's my specialty.
There we go.
Yeah, probably some Brussels sprouts.
Ooh, there you go.
Mine's a Sunday night. It's my wife and I's, it was our tradition. We got away from it a little bit, but Sunday nights, wine, pasta, what's in the fridge, what can we make up, make a dish in it, and it's just like, you know, whatever that show is on the cooking channel where you just get some ingredients and you just make it work, and, you know, you have a couple of drinks while you're cooking, you keep eating while you're cooking, and that's our Sunday evening type of a thing that I enjoy the most.
Love it. Absolutely love it.
I also love making breakfast.
Do you
a good big breakfast on a Saturday morning, you know, waffles?
I think kids remember that like you know, dad cooking.
A memory cooking. I have growing up is Sunday morning, my dad would always make us breakfast.
Yeah. Bacon.
Yeah.
And it's just bacon. You have a bacon breakfast. And like bacon. Life is good. Let's jump into I don't want to say that this is a controversial topic, but because the internet always wins. But conversation about, can you be a have a Youngstown in your name or in your brand in your business? And be not in the city limits.
By the way,
here's the reason why I ask this. Because you have 200 clients. Let's not forget.
Yeah.
iSynergy, we're here live at Stone Fruit Coffee in Poland, Ohio. You have 200 clients. Some of those probably have a Youngstown in their name in some capacity. What advice do you give to them when, you know, they have a brand and they're in the region and they're referencing the region? And how do you view that? I'll tell you what my opinion is very bluntly, because I have like three brands that are tied to the Youngstown name. I feel that Youngstown represents the region.
I would agree with that. And first of all, Warren doesn't have this problem, because nobody gets salty what? If a Howland business uses Warren in their name. I understand it as it's a region.
Okay.
So leverage it. People don't know. People might not be as familiar with Canfield or Poland or Struthers, but you say Youngstown, that gives them a general idea. And it's the way that I look at it is the same way of Cleveland suburbs using the word Cleveland, but their mailing address might be Willoughby or Lakewood.
Okay, so the follow-up question then to this is do your Cleveland and Pittsburgh, and you have clients in Florida, do those clients in those cities reference or recognize Cleveland or Miami or wherever the client is in Florida, or do they recognize Rocky River?
There's a very similar narrative, Cleveland and Pittsburgh, of you're not from the city, you're in a suburb.
Okay.
It's just not as aggressive as it is in Youngstown.
That's because of the fishbowl that we live in.
Yeah.
It's small.
And aggressive might not be the word. Same. I mean, you could also say pride, you know, because somebody that was born and raised downtown Youngstown within the city limits and still lives there. It's, I don't want to paint it as in a negative sense of aggressive, but I think they're prideful. They're proud.
Yeah.
A little bit, maybe touchy, but it happens in the other markets. It's just very much less. Much, especially Cleveland and Pittsburgh here locally. I'm sure there's some other pockets that I don't have experience in that are probably the similar. But you know, you've been out, came back. Youngstown is a very different market, right? Right.
So, 22 years out of the area, I had this conversation with somebody just yesterday. They lived away for. It was the same amount of time. I was. At the tipping point, I think it was equal amount of time, grew up here, left for 20, 21 years and came back.
It's different.
It's a really hard place to, I would say, relocate to. It's not like any other city that I'm from here. I almost had to pay a penance. Like you went away.
Yeah.
But
you know, there's certain markets where your marketing campaign, your strategy can be rinse and repeat. It's gonna what works in Charlotte is also gonna work in Pittsburgh. None of that is going to work in Youngstown. And we get, you know, we do a lot of collaboration work with larger agencies that are outside the area that have clients that, you know, their marketing initiative and strategies for Youngstown area. And they always get told, and we get a call and they're like, hey, I was told to reach out to you because Youngstown's different than any market we've ever been in. And I'm like, yeah, basically, here's what you need to know. And we kind of, you know, give them the rundown and, you know, we do some collaboration work with them and we execute here locally for them. But it's different. It's different. And I don't have the words to be able to describe it properly. I don't think it's different in a bad sense. I don't necessarily even know it's different in a good sense. I think there's probably some pros and cons both ways to it. What do you think,
Richard? I agree. I mean, I see it as respectful and a tribute to the city when a company that's maybe outside of the downtown limits is naming it after Youngstown. And I understand why people in the city might be a little defensive about that and say, oh, you're not really from Youngstown. But I just think it's a thing where people should be able to come together on it. You know, for example, you talked about coming to the market. It's a hard place to come to, not somewhere where people really think about relocating to Youngstown. We did a project recently at the Southern Park Mall, and the general manager of the mall is a guy who has been with Washington Prime Group, different markets, moved around quite a bit. And he came to Youngstown and he said, we're renting, we're not buying. He was here for a few months and said, we're buying a house here. He wanted to be here. So I just think, going back to what you said, I think it's a thing where Youngstown has come to describe the area, what people might refer to as the Mahoning Valley, maybe. From my perspective, I look at it as a positive when more places are using Youngstown as a reference point in the brands.
Sure.
No. You know, so it makes them accountable of, all right, you want to use Youngstown. How are you helping Youngstown? How is your company, even if you're not located downtown, how are you benefiting Youngstown, or how are you benefiting from Youngstown? And it's a two-way street. If you want to leverage that name, area, city, you better be on something, giving back.
I think it's difficult or challenging to know what just how much the give back is. And the assumption is that there's not a give back. I think that that comes along a little bit with the reference or the utilization of the name. And I do believe that. I think that it could be a little bit noisier here around the narrative, simply because of the fact that in a bigger city, there's just more sheer volume. So like I go back to like New York City, when I lived there, and we pissed off, like I was in healthcare, and say I pissed off a neurologist, it wasn't the end of the world, because there was like 50 more of them. But you come to Youngstown and you piss off a neurologist, you're like, well, I'm down to two.
yeah, good luck.
Right.
Godspeed.
So so everything's magnified in a smaller market. So you can hear those voices, I think, just a little bit louder.
And it's a smaller echo chamber is what it is.
Sure.
It's exactly what you described. Like, to quote one of my favorite shows, Letterkenny, bad gas travels fast in a small town. So it's going to amplify a lot more than it would in a larger city. And I think that's where a lot of the problems, but that's what differentiates the market is because it's so small. And you can,
I think, people understand that from a business perspective even better. And that's why I think Lyft Marketing gives them a unique opportunity to do that. And the reason is that you could go to the bad side of the superhero superpower, right? There's villains, and then there's, I don't want to say villains, that's the wrong term, but you could use it negatively. You could use it for the good power portion of it too, is that it's really easy in this market. I want to say easy. It's a different market, but it's easy to get your message out because of that as well. Now, whether or not, what you said, do you deliver on your product and on your service and continue to build your business that way? But like you can make a splash here like pretty quick because of that as well.
Yeah.
You just have to be careful. And we are live at Stone Fruit Coffee. So if anybody's ever coming through and we are live, you can stop in and say hi. That's fine. We really appreciate the fact that Stone Fruit is giving us the space to use this here.
But to your ultimate question, I don't think shy away from it at all. I think if you're on the north side or your south side, or you're in an area around Youngstown, or if you are in downtown Youngstown, great. But I don't think that there's any reason to shy away from it. But if you are going to do it, make sure you have a plan, make sure you have a strategy, make sure you're laid out, ready to execute, and don't deter from it.
We have to stay strong. We have to change our name from DOYO, Do Youngstown, to DOPO. Because we're in Poland.
Dupu? That's what you're gonna get.
Yeah.
Dupu.
That's what you're gonna get.
That would be amazing. I had one the other day that was, I forget what they said. It was a new one. It wasn't the DOYO. It wasn't Doy Olive. That's been the most recent one, because the email is DOYOLIVE. So they're like, are you Doy Olive? And I was like, sure. Doy Olive. That's our new name, DOYO Olive.
You can make your sponsor check out to that. That's
fine. Well, you know what? We've always been committed to the name, to the reference. I taught part-time at Youngstown State for a while. We've given tickets away to YSU students. We've always held the event in the city. And we've given back just as much as we possibly can to have the right, I guess, or the privilege to be able to use that name. And the 21 years that I was away, if anybody ever asked me, I wasn't from like Lowville, Ohio. I mean, that would get there, but I was from Youngstown. So let's switch gears into, I was on a podcast recently in the past year, and somebody did rapid fire questions. I don't know if you remember rapid fire questions. Do you remember rapid fire questions?
Yes.
Like, right?
Yeah.
And then like one of the questions was like, what's the best pizza in Youngstown? And they asked me that question and they've been on the DOYO Live show. And so like, they were like, hey, we're gonna do rapid fire questions. I was like, this sounds eerily familiar. And then they asked me like question number 7 was like, what's your favorite pizza in Youngstown? I go, that's really familiar. I was like,
we used to do that.
Hey, I'm very flattered. Somebody was listening, thought it was a good idea. We're going to do overrated, underrated, or properly rated. And you can put some narrative around it as well. So you can say why you think it is. All right? Ready?
Do it.
Donuts. Sorry, that's up. So you're looking at me like, really?
I say underrated. I love donuts. I think I hate cake. I love donuts. White House Fruit Farms.
Well,
properly rated. I'm not a big sweet eater, but I will have the occasional donut, and I'll say properly rated.
I'm going to say underrated, but I'm going to go with the maple cream stick. Is that technically a donut if it's not round?
Sure.
I call it a donut.
Yeah, it's a donut. It's a donut. I think they're a little overrated. That's it.
I mean,
done.
Everybody's allowed their opinion.
We're having some stone fruit coffee. Coffee in general. Overrated, underrated, properly rated.
Underrated.
Underrated.
Overrated.
I love coffee.
Properly rated. You said something before, like you're getting to the age where coffee kind of affects you.
Yeah.
I've had my bouts with coffee over the past few years where like it's almost like a martini, like one martini is good, two martinis okay, three you're on the ground. Coffee. One cup of coffee, great. I'm on fire. Two cups of coffee, I start to get jittery. Three cups of coffee, I get nothing done. So managing the caffeine intake is a really important aspect.
I think when I say overrated, I think it's less. I enjoy a good cup of coffee. And like Stone Fruit, I definitely think has a place. And I enjoy it. When I say overrated, like you really need a Dunkin' every three blocks. Do we need to have,
apparently,
like I don't go to Starbucks at all. It's like what, $15 for a cup of coffee? Like
it's
no
ridiculous.
I don't think so. If I'm gonna spend a decent amount of money on a cup of coffee, it better be going towards somebody here locally and not some international chain.
That's fair.
That's my thought. That's Starbucks. Like, that's where I come
chain,
from.
Chain coffee, absolute last resort. I live about 5 minutes from Nova Coffee in downtown Warren. They know me by name there. Like that's, I would rather patronize them, Stone Fruit, Ranch Street. Like I want to support the local coffee shops around here.
Yeah. Across the board.
It's still underrated.
Right? Across the board. Like local. You want to support local businesses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not just coffee shops, everywhere.
Right. Yeah. Like college football bowl games. We got the national championship coming up on Monday night. It will be an SEC all finals. We had bowl games go for about, I don't know, good better part of December into January. Any thoughts?
Oh, I go back and forth on that one. I'd say underrated just because so many people now that there's a playoff say the bowl games don't matter. The bowl games matter to a lot of those kids. But now the fact that over the last 5 to 10 years, you have the elite players, if they're not in the playoffs, they're not going to play in the bowl game because they don't want to hurt their draft stock.
Sure.
That does hurt the bowl games a little bit. I'm a Pitt graduate. And it killed me to see Kenny Pickett sit out that bowl game because they would have beat Michigan State if he was there.
Killed me, but, too, because I got a Barstool Sports app and I put $10 on the Panthers. And then I saw he wasn't playing. My son actually was like, I could have used that intel before the game.
Not during the game. Thanks.
I think for the most part, they're probably underrated, but some get overrated because of that, because of, you know, the elite players choosing not to play.
I think now they're properly rated just because, what was it, 5-10 years ago? Like, there was, like, 60 bowls or something like that. It was just blow.
The points to bowl. And
it was just too much. And now I think that it's scaled back. They made the playoffs. So I think it's nice that, there aren't too many now. And it's still, like, to be bowl eligible, I don't know if it's still the same now.
5 or 6 games.
Yeah, like that's.
We got DJ Yokley on. He dropped by. Maybe he put something in the comments here. I'm sure that he knows.
He knows something about sports?
I heard he knows something about
sports. I know a little bit.
YSN Live.
Properly rated. Although I still, and it's not the bowls, but the ranking is still ridiculous. Like,
still mad.
I'm gonna state this. I love the Ohio State Buckeyes. We had no business being in the Final Four. Neither did Michigan. I'm sorry. I'm so glad that they got taken to the woodshed by Georgia because they had no business being ranked number two. Same with Cincinnati. Good for Luke Fickle, but
I thought it was awesome that Cincinnati got. I feel like they got thrown a bone. They still got to compete. They got thrown a bone, but they almost got put out. Just to be embarrassed, because I feel like they were put at 4 to go against Alabama, so that way they could get crushed.
And they didn't. And then,
then the committee could be like, see why the power, you have to be in a power conference to make it.
Yeah.
But they held their own. They couldn't compete on the O-line, D-line. They were just overmatched with Alabama. But their talent was there. So I love the fact that even though they didn't win, it was a competitive game and they held their own.
I was pleasantly surprised watching that game because I thought it was going to be a blowout.
I'm so upset about Boise State not getting their chance. And then they rocked at, you know, they not rocked, but they beat Oklahoma.
Yeah.
It's like 15 years ago.
Yeah. I'm still upset about that because they could have competed.
That was the game where he like
the
Statue of Liberty.
Was that the year that LSU and Alabama rematched the title?
I think so.
They actually did the hook and lateral. They ran a post route over the middle. Guy catches it. The guy's coming this way, and he laterals it this way. It was amazing. It was the first time
That
was a tie the game.
Then in overtime, they ran the Statue of Liberty.
That was sweet.
What's his name? Ian something.
I thought it was Kellen.
To his girlfriend.
Right afterwards. Cheerleader.
Which that's got to you gotta win that.
Wasn't the quarterback the?
But there's a lot of things storylines there.
Wasn't the quarterback the offensive coordinator for Dallas?
Yes.
I can't Kellen some.
He is.
Yeah.
Kellen Moore.
Yeah.
He came from there.
Yeah. He was a quarterback for Boise State.
So the complaint about college basketball is that the regular season doesn't matter because the tournament has so much emphasis. Mm-hmm. But college football, I feel, is heading that direction as well. That,
DJ just chimed in.
That the regular season, I agree with him. I think the bowls are overrated because of that. Because of the ranking system, because of the fact that they've not gone deeper and figured out how to put 8-10 teams. Because I think you could get to – you don't need 65 teams like the NCAA basketball tournament.
Eight or 12,
you're pretty much there. And then you start talking about amateur athletics and injuries and things like that. But where we're at with this is that with college athletes sitting out, you know, and the opportunity to not get injured, then you're now entering this landscape that, like, bowl games basically didn't matter. Like, what happened during the regular season just a month ago to now when you have your entire starting lineup, like, wide receiver core for Ohio State? Obviously, you saw the talent of Njigba, but the rest of the team.
Olave sat out.
And so did and
Haskell
and Wilson.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And so I think that until they do that now, there's a ton of money in sponsoring. It's like really, really expensive, right? Would you put a client on name on a bowl game? Like the Tostitos changed that out to like the marketing bowl.
I think there's a place for it. Depends.
Like the Barstool the Barstool actually sponsoring a bowl game because they now have sports betting makes complete sense.
Yeah, that's a perfect fit.
That's a great fit.
But yeah, I think it gets back to like where we were, you know, there was, is Alamo Bowl still a thing? You know what I mean? Like, it just, I think if it makes sense.
NIL, that's the other thing that's a factor as well, that now name, image, and likeness, like athletes can obviously figure out a way to make some money. There's like 45 athletes down at Youngstown State that are all signed to NIL agreements. Like if you go to the website, you can see them. Most of them is Barstool, but it's also another factor that I think, I don't know, kind of plays into seeing where this all ends up going with amateur athletics. Look, most of the, so at 4 years of college football at a Division I school, there's a ton of privilege that comes along with that. You're treated really well, even at a mid-major, even at a small D1, and it's even trickled down to the D2 level. Now, it is a really nice trip for a kid that doesn't necessarily always get to go everywhere, but over a four-year college career, you've had a pretty nice go of it. But for the most part, like, the game's competitive, but, like, they're getting to go to San Antonio maybe for the first time. And I know from playing college basketball, like, we went out to Colorado for a couple tournaments, like, over Christmas, and we went here and we went there. And it was a great opportunity for me to go out and travel places like I had never been as an opportunity to go do it.
Same.
You know, like, right?
I think the first time I was ever out of country was in college when we went to the Bahamas for a training trip.
There you go.
Yeah, I mean.
Right. So there's a lot of things that come along with that. All right. Last over under underrated. I'm sorry. Overrated, underrated. Ready? The term of 2022 in digital marketing. If you're not sick of it already, you will be by next week. Metaverse.
Is it a digital marketing term or is it just a
thing? It's just a thing.
I mean, early adopters, you know, there's some major brands going heavy on it right now. They're jumping in full force. But properly rated in our space. I think it's overrated outside of our realm where people, you know, it's just like with the NFT and crypto space. Everybody and their brother thinks that they understand NFTs and crypto just because they have a wallet on their phone and they got 10 bucks and something. So I would say properly rated for our space, people that are working within, you know, the digital space, overrated for the general public.
Yeah. Agreed. I think our space, we're working to understand the ins and outs of it and how we can leverage it. Outside of the public, overrated.
I agree. To me personally, overrated. But you know, the potential could be there, you know, to do big things. So I think it's properly rated.
I firmly believe right now it's overrated because of the fact it's just in the branding and the naming. I think that the metaverse has been around and circling around us for a very long time. Like, When we in year one of DOYO in 2016, we touted virtual reality and augmented reality and ways to incorporate that into your business. And obviously that was really early, but like that's a big portion of metaverse, right? Mm-hmm. In year two, we had a keynote that was talking about blockchain technology and everybody in the crowd was like this,
right? Eyes glazed over.
But there still
no
are kind of now too. But, and then you add in crypto, NFT, and that sort of thing. So I think that these things, now they're just like, they're like putting a label on it and we're going to just shove, like, it's like saying cloud services, and that was generic. Now Meta's just like, let's just shove all this stuff in here and see where it goes.
Yeah.
NFTs is a really difficult thing to wrap your mind around, at least my mind. I feel like you're going to laugh about this. So I was looking at places to go on a mushroom retreat, not like going to hunt mushrooms, but to go take mushrooms. So my wife's probably going to kill me, but I mean, I could probably get a guy, but I'm just saying.
Everybody's got a guy.
So hear me, because like, it's so hard to wrap my mind around NFTs. And we're currently working on an NFT project for DOYO in 2022. And we have a short-term plan for this year and a long-term plan over the next like 3 years of how we can potentially evolve this. But to really understand like NFTs, like I feel like it's an alternate universe that I need to go someplace like psychedelically in order to be able to really walk away and understand it.
It's actually very simple. People just don't want to wrap their mind around it. It's a digital version. It's a digital imprint that they can purchase. Aside from that, like, that's it.
It's for people who want to say they have something that nobody else has.
Yeah.
And it's just digital. Like, instead of having it on your wall, it's...
We've had, like I said, we have clients all over the world. Patrick Memoran, he's a former owner of Lamborghini, is a client of ours. He is an artist. He started, his artist name is Duck Dive. We've been working with him for 5-6 months. And it's all about him, you know, becoming an NFT artist and out of the traditional space, because he's always done digital, you know, video, audio, traditional campaigns. He's has exhibitions all over the world. And we've been promoting him as an NFT artist and how to go to market, how to create that. Because NFTs aren't like a traditional, I want to buy Monet. They aren't that. NFTs are, I want to support you as an artist. I know I don't have something tangible that I'm going to hang on my wall, but I love you as an artist. I love what you're doing. I want to support you in your quest and in your journey throughout this, what you're doing. I'm going to buy one of your NFTs for $20, $50, $5,000, $10,000, because I want to support you. It's community-based. It's not necessarily investor-based. Does that make sense?
It does. Where it starts to get complicated is now, because of blockchain and crypto, which is the currency, right? I mean, so because of that, you now have a resell value to the digital token, if you will.
Yeah.
And the original owner can get royalty off of that resell.
Correct.
And so where that
resale market is very, very minimal.
Now it's minimal. So what we're trying to figure out is this, is with the conference, you know, like I could very easily, and we've done it. Like we were like, hey, we're going to incentivize people that are, you know, speakers or, you know, so-called influencers that, you know, feel that they can drive traffic. So we'll give you an affiliate link or a promo code. And people inevitably don't end up utilizing the affiliate code, ends up getting broken because somebody goes and shops around a website and then they go back and they make a purchase. So you lose that trackability or that credit. If they don't use the promo code, you don't get credit. But on the blockchain, so we can offer that now. But if we offer an NFT ticket to a sponsor and don't rely on affiliate links and we don't rely on a promo code that somebody may or may not use, you can go out and sell on the blockchain an NFT ticket to DOYO and secure that payment for you and obviously any royalty like that I build into that percentage of sell. So I think that's kind of an interesting,
aspect. You roll back to blockchain and that's the technology that is going to transcend and change the world over the next 3 to 5 years.
Yeah.
In spaces that we can't even comprehend yet. It's going to transcend geos. It's, you know, because it's global. It's going to transcend spaces, retail, you know, marketing, investing, anything. It's going to be everywhere.
People that somebody said something to me, they're like, they kind of laughed at the, and it's fine because like it happens a lot. Like, but it was like, good luck with that. Ha ha. NFT, you know? And I said, well, you don't really realize it, but like you're already using some of that to some capacity, at least the blockchain transactions. So my example was like, I bought tickets to go to an Ohio State football game from an individual buyer. And we transition the e-ticket secure in a secure environment. Mm-hmm. So there's no longer that person standing out on the street corner selling you a fake ticket.
Scalping tickets.
This has been certified, verified with technology through blockchain that makes that all secure. So interesting. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for dropping on by. We are live today at Stone Fruit Coffee. DOYO Live, the DOYO Live marketing show is brought to you now by Lyft Marketing, as is DOYO Live is presented by Lyft Marketing, a iSynergy business brand. So thank you, Steve Cross, Becky Bertuzzi, Brian.
Dan.
Why did I say that? Why am I thinking of Brian? I'm an idiot. It says right there in front of me. Anyway.
Getlifted.io.
Getlifted.io. Thank you, everybody, for dropping on by today. Everybody have a great, safe weekend. Enjoy that snow out there. We'll be back next Friday live from Stone Fruit Coffee with Diana Kaufman. Thank you. See you.